See theater, so I just came to the theater. I don't even know it. Starting off with the next session, so let's go on with the exams. The idea of this entire series of the next 15 to 20 talks is going to be to help you understand how do you take a case in the exams, and also how do you exactly present a case in the exam. That's the entire idea of this next 15 to 20 talks. We'll be starting off with the cases. The first and most important and most frequently asked for your exams is on uveitis. So we would have a discussion on uveitis. How do you exactly take a case of uveitis? And how do you present a case of uveitis? We have Dr. Nidhi, consultant at Shankara Eye Hospital, Bangalore, who is a consultant in the Department of Medical Retina and Uvea. Dr. Nidhi would be able to help you out to understand how do you present a case of anterior uveitis. Over to Nidhi.
So good afternoon. Today we'll talk about approach to a case of anterior uveitis. So when you get a case of anterior uveitis, slides are not moving. We'll start with how to take a case of an anterior uveitis. So first, you always have to, whenever you see a case of a red eye, you have to identify whether it's a uveitic or a non-uveitic entity. So the signs and the symptoms of the patient will help you in defining whether this is a uveitic entity or not. So once you know that this is a uveitis, you have to determine which part of the uveal tract is predominantly affected by the inflammation, whether it's the anterior uvea, the intermediate, or the posterior segment. Many a times there can be a overlap between the two parts. Anterior uveitis can be associated with intermediate as well as posterior uveitis, or all the three may be affected when it's called as a panuveitis. So that will give you an anatomical diagnosis of your uveitis. Then you have to study, you have to identify what is the pathologic type of the uveitis, whether it's a granulomatous or a non-granulomatous. That will help you in your lab investigations, because the cause for a granulomatous as well as that of a non-granulomatous are going to be different. So based on your whether it's granulomatous or non-granulomatous, you can further investigate the patient. Then you have to stage the disease, the clinical chronology of the uveitis, whether it's an acute uveitis or a chronic uveitis. Because this is important in patients who have a long-standing chronic uveitis, you have to expect associated sequelae and in complications of uveitis like cataract, glaucoma, cystoid macular edema. You have to particularly look for them in addition to your uveitic findings, which you're going to see. And then finding out the associations, because we all know that uveitis is an immune-mediated process, and a number of autoimmune diseases can be associated with uveitis. It can be associated with some infections, because infections are known to weaken the immune system, as well as some malignancies. So identifying those causes will make one thing is that ophthalmologist may be the first person to determine the presence of the systemic disease and greatly reduce the ocular morbidity. Even systemic morbidity, if you treat the systemic disease. And Secondly, treatment of systemic disease will also control your ocular inflammation better. The recurrence rates may reduce, and treatment also will modify according to the systemic disease presence. So just like all flus are not COVID-19, similarly, all red eyes are not uveitic. So how do you differentiate whether this red eye is a uveitic entity or not? So first, you know, you need to see what's the type of congestion, whether you have a sectoral congestion or your diffuse congestion. So if it's a sectoral congestion, it's more likely to be a nodular scleritis, episcleritis, an inflamed pingicula or pterygium. Whereas a more diffuse one, when you see a diffuse condition, then it's more likely to be a uveitis. But then again, if it's a diffuse condition, it's only the bulbar or even the palpable conjunctiva which is involved. If both are involved, then more likely to be a conjunctivitis. Whereas if only the bulbar conjunctiva is involved, again, you need to see where is the amount of condition more. If it's in the circumcorneal area, then it's more likely to be a uveitis. If it's the entire bulbar conjunctiva, it can be some different form of conjunctiva. So once you know what is the, so that will help you in your diagnosis. The patient's symptoms like pain and photophobia particularly is very specific to uveitis because exposure to light, pupillary constriction, ciliary muscle constriction will cause a pain as these are all inflamed inside. And apart from that, in addition to the photophobia, patient will also have pain in the head, in the scalp area, in the periorbital area. That's because the sensory supply of the ciliary muscle and the pupillary sphincter is from the from the trigeminal nerve, the nasolipociliary distribution of the trigeminal nerve. So the pain may be radiating to other distributions of the trigeminal nerve also. So this, whereas in case of conjunctivitis, the pain is not very severe. In case of acute angle closure glaucoma, again, you have other symptoms like colored halos, and the signs will help you in distinguishing the condition. Then the other symptoms are blurred vision, which the patient will complain of in uveitis, whether it be anterior or a posterior uveitis, because of the media haze, cells in flare obscuring the vision. And also floaters. Floaters is a very specific symptom of more of intermediate and posterior uveitis and unlikely symptom of an anterior uveitis. So based on the symptoms also, you can distinguish whether it's an anterior or posterior segment or intermediate uveitis, which you're dealing with. Then coming to, once you know the symptoms, based on symptoms, you have some idea, then you go to the signs, the ocular signs, which you see in patients with uveitis, as we discussed about the condition, then go on to a slit lamp examination. On slit lamp examination, you see basically keratic precipitates on the corneal endothelium. So these keratic precipitates may be as large and easily visible as like in this slide, where you can see them on diffuse illumination and dot plot examination, you get these large keratic precipitates, or they may be very small and medium sized, for which you will have to make a slit beam and use an indirect focal illumination and focus it on the endothelium, where you can see these medium and small sized keratic precipitates on at the level of endothelium. So when you're describing a keratic precipitate, you always have to first tell what's the size. So they are small, medium-sized, or very fine keratic precipitates, or large, much fat or greasy keratic precipitates. Secondly, you have to see the distribution of these keratic precipitates, whether they are distributed only in the inferior Ahl's triangle, which is where they are commonly seen because of the aqueous currents, or whether they are distributed more over the entire endothelium. So when they are distributed more uniformly all over the endothelium, then you think more of a Fuchs uveitic entity or viral uveitis, unlike the other uveitic entities where it's more commonly confined to the inferior part. Then once you distribution of KPs, you have to determine whether they are active keratic precipitates or they are old keratic precipitates. So how do you distinguish between an active and an old keratic precipitates? By seeing those, whereas active ones you can see have a three-dimensionality, they are voluminous, they are round, you can see them protruding into the anterior chamber. The older keratic precipitates will be more flatter, they'll be more shrunken, dried out, shriveled, and they may also be pigmented like this. So these are all resolving keratic precipitates. Sometimes there may be a halo or ring of halo around the resolving keratic precipitate, which is suggesting that this is a healing stage of the uveitis. This is an old uveitis where there's all pigmented old keratic. These three important things which you have to describe with association of with when you're describing a keratic precipitate. So now you might, so this now, there might be some confusing things or mimickers also. These are not keratic precipitates because you can see they are very shiny, crystalline and refractile dots. And they are not just from the endothelium, they are also present on the corneal stroma. So this is actually a case of drug toxicity due to chlorpromazine in antipsychotic use for schizophrenia. This was seen bilaterally in both eyes, symmetrical. So this is a phototoxic reaction towards chlorpromazine, which causes this kind of deposits. So you have to differentiate that deposits from keratic precipitates. So sometimes you might have this kind of a picture where you have a large stromal edema, stromal keratitis. You think, okay, this is a case of a stromal keratitis on a diffuser, a cursory examination, diffuse illumination. But when you actually make a slit beam and you look deeper into the cornea, you can actually see these large pigmented keratic precipitates, which are voluminous and they are active keratic precipitates. So now your diagnosis changes from a stromal keratitis to uveitis. So there's a component of uveitis when you carefully look at this picture. So when you also go back and look at the iris, you can see this diffuse atrophy of the iris. You can see this pupil is fixed and dilated. That's because of the sphincter atrophy. So this is actually a case of viral keratouveitis. We confirmed this on a PCR test, polymerase chain reaction. It was found out to be HSV-1 positive. So these are the typical things which you should look for and not miss out just by seeing just on a cursory examination. A more detailed examination is important. So now coming, once we have seen the cornea, now we go into the anterior chambers. What are the anterior chamber findings in a patient with uveitis? So usually you have cells and flare in the anterior chamber. So how do you detect them is by using a small 1:1 millimeter beam with high magnification and a high illumination. You can identify the presence of these inflammatory cells, macrophages, and lymphocytes, which leak out from the hyperpermeable capillaries of the iris in the ciliary body. These cells are further graded from 0 to 4 by the standardized uveitis nomenclature. They have graded them from 0 to 4 based on the number of cells, from 0 to 5, 5 to 15, 15 to 25, 25 to 50, or more than 50, from 0 to 4. And even the flare is basically because of the leaking of proteins in a plasma within the aqueous, which causes this protein scattering of light, is visible as a flare. So you have to also grade the flare. That grading is done based on the visibility of the underlying iris details, based on which you can grade the flare also from 1 to 4. So grading of uveitis or the cells and flare is important because based on the severity of uveitis, your treatment also has to be more aggressive for more severe uveitis in order to prevent the development of complications. So now, once you've seen the anterior chamber, so other things what you have to look also in the anterior chamber is the depth of the AC. Many a times, these patients with uveitis, especially viral keratouveitis, can have open angle secondary glaucomas, whereas also because of the formation of synechiae, you might have secondary angle closure glaucomas because of pupillary block, causing iris bombae and peripheral anterior closure, angle closure. So you might have. So that's the reason anterior chamber depth evaluation also has to be done whenever we are looking for cells and flare to identify associated sequelae of the uveitis. Now, once you've gone through the anterior chamber depth, you have to look at the iris. Now, the iris in cases of uveitis, particularly in patients with a chronic or a granulomatous uveitis, you can see these white colored nodules, usually on the, as well as at the pupillary margin copies and also at the base, that is called as the Busakas nodules. So these are nothing but granulomas present on the iris. The iris might also be plastered onto the anterior capsule, particularly at the pupillary area. So you might find these posterior synechiae. They might be very subtle and be missed out on the cursory examination, but when you dilate the pupil and you can see these festooned pupil to will further confirm your, you might think, yeah, probably there's a posterior synechiae, which is confirmed when you dilate the pupil. So these are the iris findings. Apart from this granulomas in the iris, you can also sometimes on long-standing cases see loss of pattern. The crypts, the collarets might be slightly reduced. The balding of iris might be seen in patients with chronic uveitis. Or you can also sometimes see new vessels on the iris in long-standing uveitis. Or neovascularization is also known to occur, as well as a particular roseola kind of picture is seen in case of syphilitic uveitis, where you can see these dilated capillaries of the iris. So once you've seen, looked at the iris, then go on to the lens. The anterior capsule of lens might show these kind of pigment deposits. This suggests that there has been a uveitis in this patient in the past at some time. Okay, So this will help you in identifying that this patient might be having a acute recurrent, or he had a chronic uveitis and he might be normal now. The lens may also show cataractous changes because, as a complication of uveitis. So once you've seen through the lens, then look at the anterior vitreous also. You can make that small slit beam of 1 into 1 millimeter, try to defocus, go deeper through the from the posterior capsule into the anterior vitreous. You can look for presence of vitreous cells. So vitreous cells will also may be present even in the case of anterior uveitis. That is because of the close proximity of the structures. There might be spillover vitritis. So that is actually where how you will differentiate is only in the anterior vitreous when you see cells, and if you defocus or you look at through a 90D, you will not see any cells in the posterior vitreous. So that will tell you a clue that this is only a spillover vitritis and it's not actually an anterior plus the posterior or an intermediate uveitis you're dealing with. So now also secondly, fundus examination is important. I have not put any fundus picture because this is more of anterior uveitis, but fundus examination is absolutely essential in patients with anterior uveitis because cystoid macular edema is known to happen in many of the cases of chronic as well as anterior recurrent and severe forms of uveitis. So fundus evaluation and many of the posterior uveitis like toxoplasma retroparotitis can also present with the granulomatous anterior uveitis. So not to, you know, because we know that one condition cannot just involve only one part of the eye. It can also involve the posterior segment, and hence the posterior segment examination is absolutely essential in all the cases of uveitis. Now, as I was telling you how to differentiate, how to make a pathological diagnosis. So you have certain features which will help you in telling whether it's a granulomatous or non-granulomatous KPs. So when you see these large button fat, greasy keratic crystals, you know this is a granulomatous uveitis. Whereas in case of non-granulomatous, do you see these fine, small or medium-sized keratic crystals? Also, iris nodules are more likely to present, which I showed you, like Coppes and Bosatas, in case of granulomatous uveitis, unlikely in cases of non-granulomatous uveitis. And the amount of exudation, like fibrinous reaction or cells and flares, is much more severe in a non-granulomatous uveitis, whereas in a granulomatous, there might be more incidence scores. And posterior synechiae can be broad and dense in patients with granulomatous uveitis. And they may be smaller and tenuous or thinner in cases of non-granulomatous uveitis. So now coming to the clinical staging of uveitis, whether it's an acute or a chronic or it's acute recurrent, why do you want to define them like that? It's because the etiology is different in each case. Now, if you know that this is an acute uveitis, single episode, it can be because of trauma, it can be just a reaction to some distant infection like infected tooth extraction, a sinus infection, and these conditions are usually very self-limiting, they heal very well with treatment, and you don't need to bother about them coming repeatedly back to you. They do not need to be investigated much. Whereas an acute recurrent anterior uveitis is more commonly seen in patients with ankylosing spondylitis, with viral infections, like herpes viridae group of viruses, and Posner-Schwarzen syndrome, also patients will have acute recurrent episodes of uveitis along with high eye pressures. Phaco antigenic, if you do not remove the retained lens matter or even sometimes the phacomorphic or glaucoma in a hypermature cataract can also produce this lens-induced uveitis can be there. Then your chronic uveitis, you get it more likely in patients who have a viral herpes group of infections, tuberculosis, sarcoidosis can present with the chronic uveitis. Fuchs uveitis is a chronic uveitis. GIE also presents with the chronic uveitis. Retained intraocular foreign bodies, if the underlying foreign body is not removed, also the patient will keep having a chronic and a recurrent form of inflammation, which responds to steroid but comes back each time. So that's what that's the importance of knowing whether it's an acute or a chronic form of inflammation. Then how do you determine what is the cause for this underlying uveitis? So you have to take a very thorough history. So once you made a diagnosis, okay, you know this is an acute, non-granulomatous, anterior uveitis. So then what do you want to do? You want to know what's the cause for the uveitis. As we said, that systemic associations can be there. So by taking a proper ocular history, you can and systemic history, you will have some idea about what further you need to do for these patients. So if it's an acute, as I said, you can have certain causes. For chronic patients, you can have some different, as in the previous slide I explained. Then age of onset is important because in the pediatric age group, like below 16 years, you would think, especially a girl, you might think more of a JIA, juvenile idiopathic arthritis associated uveitis. In much more smaller children, less than 5 years of age, 4 years, you might think of Bloss syndrome, which is of the sarcoidic uveitis, or you might also think of masquerades like a retinoblastoma causing uveitis. Whereas in adult patient, if you also with this acute uveitis, you might think of HLAP 27 uveitis. You might think in a middle-aged person, you might think of a viral uveitis. So depending on the age group, you might have different etiologies for the uveitis. Duration, again, chronicity is important to identify. The first thing is it also helps in differentiating the cause, as well as to see, look for presence of complications. You have to look for presence of cataract, glaucoma, cystoid macular edema, and all the other complications of uveitis, which might be coexisting and therefore require a proper management. History of trauma and surgery is very important, because if, in the case a patient who has a history of trauma or traumatic uveitis doesn't need any further investigation, just giving treatment for that particular episode is sufficient. You don't need to do any further investigations. Or even a post-surgery uveitis also, most of the times might just be a single episode if it's inflammatory. Rarely it can be an cause of an infectious, it might be a sign of infectious endophthalmitis, in which case you have to investigate further. So that's the importance of that history. And treatment history is important because for your drug-induced uveitis, a number of drugs, both ocular as well as topical AGMs, like anti-glaucoma medications like brimonidine, is known to induce a granulomatous anti-uveitis. A number of systemic medications are also known to cause uveitis, like topiramate, which is an anti-migraine medicine, even astazolamide, even fluoroquinolone and group of antibiotics is known to cause the uveitis. So if you know this, so this treatment history is also important in a patient. When you know this, it's a drug induced, you don't need to further investigate the patient. So that's the importance of history there. Then other factors which has to be looked at is age. As I discussed, there are certain diseases more common in certain ages, age groups. Sex is important because, again, certain diseases, like if you have a young male with a vasculitis, you might think of Eales disease, you might think of Behçet's disease, whereas a young girl, a lady who comes with a chronic uveitis picture and she had a past history of exudative RD, you might think of BKH. So again, and then race, so Mediterranean people more likely to have Behçet's disease, Japanese race is more likely to have VKH. So similarly, there might be a racial predilection also to certain diseases, and the geographic location is of importance in that case. So then coming to the systemic history is important to identify the systemic associations of your uveitis, because you have to also treat the patient as a whole and not just the eye, and your treatment also might alter with the type of disease which the patient has. So so the most important history is specifically joint pains, and along with the pain, you should always ask for stiffness and swelling in the joints, because joint pain might just be a very non-specific symptom which might be there because of osteoarthritis in an elderly patient. So presence of stiffness and swelling will give you further clues to whether there was an arthritic swelling because of inflammation, it's an autoimmune kind of inflammation, or it was just a specific inflammation. And not just the peripheral joints, even the axial skeleton has to be asked for, particularly the especially in young people. Whereas in children, as I said, GIA is more common cause for uveitis. In adults, it's not RA. Rheumatoid arthritis is not very common, but it's more likely spondylitis, ankylosing spondylitis, and hence asking for upper or lower back pain is very important in these patients, because they may not by themselves tell it unless you actually ask for it. So then fever, history of fever is important in patients with tuberculosis, leptospirosis, or systemic GIA patients were also present with a fever. And many times viral fevers like dengue, chikungunya, West Nile virus can all also be followed by a development of a uveitis. So taking a proper history also is important of fever. Then cough will help you in determining presence of any pulmonary diseases like sarcoid, or if it's a dry cough, or whether there's with expectoration, you can identify the presence of pulmonary disease. Then weight loss, history of weight loss will guide you towards probably presence of some chronic infection which is causing malnutrition to the patient, or inflammatory bowel diseases causing a malnourishment, or malignancies which could be the reason for this uveitis. And history of oral and genitourinary ulcers is one of the major criteria for Behçet's disease. So when you see a patient with vasculitis and you also have these symptoms within this history, then you might think of probably Behçet's disease. Similar oral genitourinary ulcers may also be found in Reuter's disease, which is a triad of arthritis, urethritis, and uveitis. And also in syphilis, though primary syphilis very less common, but secondary and tertiary syphilis more likely to be associated with uveitis. But even in secondary syphilis, you might have mucopurulent lesions. So asking for that history is important. skin lesions will asking for history of skin lesions. Like in a sarcoid, you might have skin granulomas, like the multiforming painful granulomas. So that will give you an idea. Yeah, probably the patient has a sarcoidosis. This patient might have vasculitic rashes, skin rashes. Sometimes you might see a vitiligo, which might be there in cases of VKH, especially but in pigmented races when the sunset glow is not so evident. And in the chronic stage, a patient keeps coming back with the granulomatous inflammation. These signs, my integumentary signs, will help you in identifying the presence of VKH. And then Hansen's disease, we know that leprumatous lesions on the skin, hypertrophic skin lesions, hypopigmented lesions, and all will be pointing to that particular diagnosis. And history of drug. As we said, drug-induced uveitis is a known entity. Eliminating that drug will be, most of the times, produces a magical effect of almost eliminating the inflammation. You don't need a very long-term treatment. But not identifying the drug and not eliminating it will result in development of a uveitis, which usually becomes recalcitrant, doesn't respond to your therapy, and patient may lose the eye also. So now coming to the case scenarios, so that you can understand better what these are the cases which are very commonly seen in your UVA practice when you're sitting and seeing patients. This is what you will see. So these that's why I have taken a few examples and then how you will go about them. So this patient, young adult male patient, comes with a severe acute anterior uveitis, and when you examine, you can see the circumconvulsory condition. Usually there's just very fine dusting in these patients, so the KPs are not very clearly visible on your diffuse illumination. They will have a severe AC reaction of cells grade 3 plus 4 plus and flare, and you can see this fibrin hypopyon here in the lower part, and on you can also see a fibrin membrane on the anterior of lens once you dilate the pupil like this. So the pupillary membrane may not be visible in the undilated. So what is your diagnosis in these cases? So now you look at the patient very carefully. So when you see this, you can see this frozen spine which the patient has in this typical hunchback appearance. So this is usually a feature of, he has this ankylosing spondylitis, which is one of the very common causes for a hypopyon anterior uveitis in the clinic. So what is HLA-B27 uveitis? What are the features? HLA-B27 uveitis is common in young adults, 30 to 40 years of age. It's unilateral. Bilateral involvement is very rare. And bilateral simultaneous involvement is very rare. Bilateral, the other eye may be involved in the second episode and some other episode. And usually presents with acute uveitis. And usually there's a history of a past episode of inflammation, because they usually have a tendency to having recurrent episodes of inflammation. And this treated for their spondylitis or for the associated systemic condition. So the degree of reaction is very severe. They usually have a fibrinous exudation in the anterior chamber or hypopyon formation. Posterior segment is usually spared. Very rarely HLA-B27 vasculitis has also been reported, but that normally for normal purposes it's usually rare. And if not treated, there can be associated dense vitritis and stored macular edema also. So other conditions associated with HLA-B27 positivity in addition to ankylosing spondylitis are reactive arthritis syndromes, reiters, inflammatory bowel diseases, and psoriatic arthritis. So all these things, based on your symptoms, if you get a triad or if you have this a very thin patient having frequency diarrhea and passing mucus, so they or blood in stool, you know that this pipe probably has an inflammatory bowel disease, or psoriatic arthritis, you can see the onycholysis, you can see the distal interphalangeal joint having swelling. What are the differential other causes of hypopyon anterior uveitis? In addition to the inflammations, even certain neoplasias and infections can cause hypopyon anterior uveitis. So this was the first one is HLA-B27 associated. So how do you differentiate and Behçet's disease is another inflammation which can cause hypopyon. How do you differentiate is, whereas in Behçet's, the hypopyon usually shifts freely. It moves with the position of your head. If you make the patient move his head laterally, you can see the hypopyon moves after some time. And it usually forms a smooth layer. It responds very well to treatment, melts away with treatment. Is actually B27 uveitis related hypopyon will be more sticky, it will be more fibrinous, and it doesn't move freely, and it also takes a little time for the resolution to happen. And certain neoplasias like leukemias can also present with this white hypopyon, which usually doesn't respond very well to steroid treatment. And this is a picture of a post-op patient. So if you get a patient with a history of previous intraocular surgery recently, you get this steamy or edematous cornea with the corneal stromal haze, you get this hypopyon, and at the section, you can see there's infiltrate. So then you can think of an infectious cause of a hypopyon. Now coming to the second case, this is a case of, you can see these large mutton fat keratic prostrate circumcorneal incisionary condition. This is another case, the patient has a large iris granuloma or at the in the angle. You can also see this again, large KPs with Copase nodules and other iris nodules all over the iris. Or when you see these posterior synechiae forming and along with this granulomatous KPs. So then now you know this is a case of your acute granulomatous anterior uveitis. And importance of making a diagnosis of granulomatous anterior uveitis is because there are a number of systemic diseases associated with granulomatous anterior uveitis. So proper systemic history becomes important in these patients because your investigations will be based on your systemic history and your systemic examination. So presence of respiratory illness, fever, nodules, skin ulcers, a review of systems by the physician or by a specialist consultation is important in these patients. Depending on what symptoms you get or what systemic history you get, you can send. If the patient complains more of chest symptoms, you can send to a pulmonologist. If the patient complains of skin ulcers or rashes, probably a venereal disease specialist might be required. So depending on that, you can also take a specialist opinion and specific lab tests according to whatever you are suspecting. So if you are thinking, yeah, probably this is more of a pulmonary illness associated with the granulomatous, you will think of ruling out sarcoidosis and tuberculosis as your first differential diagnosis. If you think that this patient is having more of ulcers or some, you know, mouth ulcers or mucocutaneous lesions, you might think of also ruling out other conditions like syphilis or other things. So what are the differential causes of, what are the causes of granulomatous anterior uveitis? You know that tuberculosis and sarcoidosis, both of them are granulomatous systemic multi-system disorders. So they can also, they present with also granulomatous anterior uveitis. Syphilis can present with any form, either granulomatous, non-granulomatous, any form of uveitis, anterior, posterior, intermediate, everything. Leprosy again can also present with the granulomatous uveitis and gammas. Toxoplasma, as I said, is another condition which can present with the granulomatous anterior uveitis. So you, hence, in all these conditions, a posterior fundus examination is also very, very important because all of them can also, in addition to anterior uveitis, cause varying degrees of posterior segment involvement. And one of the important non-infectious causes of granulomatous anterior uveitis is VKH, Wok-Kayanagi-Hallermann disease, has to be kept in mind. Patients who present with this granulomatous anterior uveitis. So based on that, you will investigate accordingly because a battery of tests giving this non-specific test becomes very expensive to the patient. So you need to identify based on your history and systemic examination what may be the likely cause and accordingly give those blood tests. So a complete blood count, differential counts, presence of reactive lymphocytosis is more likely a feature of granulomatous diseases like TB or sarcoid, in which you get a reactive lymphocyte values will be much higher. A chest X-ray will help in identifying presence of any consolidation in the lung or presence of any old scars, which might be Gons focus, which might give you a clue that, okay, probably there might be some form of tuberculosis exposure. VDRL is a non-specific venereal test for treponema, and VDRL is, usually they say that a combination of a non-specific plus a specific test is diagnostic of treponema pallidum infection or syphilis, and hence usually both has to be done, or at least if not a more specific like a TPH and treponema pallidum, hematuria test is more useful than just a VDRL alone. So to rule out syphilitic infections, serum ACE or angiotensin converting enzymes will be elevated in patients with sarcoidosis. So whenever a patient has a granulomatous uveitis, has some chest symptoms, you will like to do these investigations. A MANTO is a tubercular skin test. And usually it's in endemic countries, we usually consider a little higher value of more than 15 as a cutoff because 10 to 15 is considered as borderline because they're all immunized. But if you get a borderline MANTO doing a QuantiFERON TB gold, which is an immunoglobulin release assay test, IGRA test, will also add value to your MANTO findings. HRCT test is particularly useful whenever you're suspecting sarcoidosis, where in which case this mediastinal lymph nodes, the bilateral symmetrical hilar lymphadenopathy, which is a typical feature, is better seen on a CT scan because the lymph nodes might be very small to be picked up on an X-ray. Then AC-TAP is the final thing. AC-TAP for PCR, pulmonary stain reaction. Nowadays, PCR has become very important following that you know that PCR is the test for choice for COVID-19 also. So anti-retrieval TAP to identify any of these organisms, mycobacteria, atypical mycobacteria, or even particularly viral. So viral uveitis can also sometimes present with a granulomatous inflammation. So virus has to be usually diagnosed by doing these genetic tests. So one, so that will complete your investigations for granulomatous uveitis. Now coming to the third case. So this is a case scenario: middle-aged woman, 50-year-old, complains of mild blurring of vision. On her vision is 6x6. So on slit lamp examination, you can see the circumciliary condition. You can see these medium-sized pigmented keratic precipitates more on the lower inferior part, and some amount of corneal edema, which is not very clearly seen here because of the raised intraocular pressure, which was almost recorded as 40 millimeters. So this, when you get this kind of picture of a hypertensive anterior uveitis with not very, very severe, not a fibrinous kind of reaction, just a mild to moderate iridial anterior chamber reaction and pigmented keratic precipitates, you should think of a viral uveitis and particularly a CMV anterior uveitis. So this is one of the important causes for very high pressures in the eye in addition to uveitis. So usually CMV, what are the features of a CMV anterior uveitis? It's usually a unilateral condition, very rarely in 7% bilateral. It's most commonly seen in middle-aged and elderly people, 50 to 80 years of age, and also presents with recurrent anterior uveitis, and IOP spikes are there. Usually there's very high IOP seen during the acute episodes of the uveitis, and the degree of reaction is usually mild from 1+ cells. Patients can have KPs, which can be fine stellate, similar to that of a Fuchs case, or they may be coin-shaped, or they may be pigmented, and the typical linear arrangement of KPs has been described in patients with CMV anterior uveitis. The endothelial lesions, there can be nodular lesions on the endothelium surrounded by a halo, which is also a typical feature of CMV anterior uveitis. Usually the specular microscopy is very useful because many of the patients with anterior uveitis CMV will also have an endothelitis, and hence endothelial cell counts might also be low in this. So that will also add to your diagnosis of CMV endothelitis with the uveitis. So usually posterior sinecure absent, though it's a granulomatous inflammation, or sometimes even large coin-shaped KPs may be present, but there'll be no posterior sinecure. And posterior segment is totally uninvolved in patients who have a CMV anterior uveitis, because they're all immunocompetent. So what are the investigations you want to do for a patient with CMV anterior uveitis? As I said, anterior chamber tap. You have to take the echoes and send it for polymerase chain reaction, either multiplex PCRs, or you can also use real-time PCR to actually see the viral load, and that will determine your treatment. Many a times, this PCR test might be negative because of the lack of sensitivity and specificity. So repeat PCR test may have to be done many a times for these patients, though the diagnosis is usually clinical. So once you see this particular clinical features, you can start them, these patients, on antiviral therapy with valganciclovir for the treatment of CMV uveitis, which will just not respond only to steroids. Here you have to use valganciclovir, either gel as well as oral tablets, to control the inflammation, as well as prevent the development of a glaucoma in these patients. So, and they also need anti-glaucoma medications, which is a must in all these patients. So this is another case. This is also similar to that of a CMV, but it's slightly different. So what here you see is this large, medium-sized, small to medium-sized white keratocrystates within the iris triangle. On the iris, when you can see these patchy areas of sectoral iris atrophy. You can see the sphincter atrophy also. Or you might see this diffuse patchy atrophy. You might see these are old pigmented keratic precipitates. So this is a healed form of the same condition. So what are the features? So this is actually a case of a herpetic viral anterior uveitis, usually caused by HSV as well as VZV. So they are usually unilateral. They are present with pigmented keratic precipitates, more common in the inferior cornea. They can also be stellate KPs, similar to that of Fuchs, which may be distributed all over the endothelium. You might have telltale signs of a keratitis, like nummular lesions on the cornea or some old dendritic scars which might be present, and decreased corneal sensations, which is very useful for making a diagnosis of a herpetic viral keratitis. Secondly, iris atrophy in these cases can be either diffuse or segmental, which is more segmental. Sectoral atrophy is more common in herpes simplex type 1, whereas diffuse is more likely in zoster virus. So you get a dilated pupil because of the sphincter atrophy. The pupil might be dilated, and raised intraocular pressures because of the associated viral trabeculitis. Most of these herpetic viruses also associated with the trabeculitis, which causes a raised intraocular pressure. And as I said, concomitant corneal disease, and particularly corneal sensations. When you do not find any corneal scars, doing a corneal sensation, reduced corneal sensation is a very important indicator that it could be a viral keratouveitis or viral uveitis now. So how do you differentiate HSV from a CMV? Clinically is by that CMV usually for presence of the milder uveitis, fewer KPs and no sine K and very high IOPs beyond 40. Whereas in HSV, hepatic, usually the reaction might be variable and the IOPs do not usually go beyond 40. Now coming to the Fuchs uveitis syndrome, this is actually Fuchs uveitis, and again is a very it's a chronic artery uveitis, very commonly seen in our practice. So you can get these stellate shaped KPs. Stellate is actually comet shaped. They have a small tail to them, or even they might have spidery fingers or webs. They might have branches to them. So this KPs are distributed all over the endothelium in case of Fuchs. Secondly, the iris might be hypochromic. So when you compare the two eyes, the affected eye will be hypochromic. The iris might show this moth-eaten pattern of atrophy within it. And another, usually the eyes are white. There's no pain and redness in these patients. Though it's a uveitis, they usually are asymptomatic. So the typical features will be that the patient again has a unilateral chronic anti-uveitis in an otherwise white eye. And they may have these stellate KPs or comet-shaped KPs, which is all scattered all over the endothelium, the moth-eaten and hypochromic iris, no posterior sine K. The main cause they come for in the clinic is because of the diminution of vision due to cataract formation. Till then, they do not have any symptoms. So they come only with the complications like cataract or even sometimes with high pressures. So apart from that, they will also have a lot of vitreous floaters, and the systolic macular edema is never seen in patients with Fuchs uveitis. So that will help you in making a diagnosis of Fuchs. So when you know this is a Fuchs uveitis, you don't need to do investigations further because there's no systemic associations. You don't need to identify the cause. It's a idiopathic uveitis. And now coming to a very rare cause like retained intraocular foreign body. So this patient presented with this large, you can see this kind of a exudate sitting on the endothelium with your severe exudative reaction. So we thought, and he had a history of trauma, we could see some kind of a entry wound at the limbus or something. So we thought probably this is some kind of fungal uveitis, and we treated him with both steroids as well as antifungals. And once the exudate reduced, you can see these exudates. Once they reduced, you could see something black here. It's actually a foreign body. So this patient had come twice. He had this inflammation. He got better, but then he was not totally, it was not totally resolved. So only when we identified this foreign body and did the foreign body removal, did this patient actually finally get rid of his uveitis. And hence, looking for this. So in the case of trauma, so history, and then with the history correspondingly, you have to look for any intraocular foreign body which could be causing this, your disease. So this comes to the end of my presentation. So I would like to, if there's any questions, we can have the questions now.
Thank you, Dr. Nidhi, for that wonderful presentation. A few questions. So if they get a case of anterior uveitis on the exam, what are the most important history or the negative history you would expect the student to be telling across?
So in a case of anterior uveitis, the important history is, first of all, ask for the particular signs, like your the symptoms. Symptoms is very important, pain, photophobia, and all that. Apart from that, we take a complete history. So though if it's just a simple anterior non-granulomatous uveitis, we'll start with first of all back pain, if any back stiffness of any other joints pain or joint stiffness, if any other is a cough and fever, because again in an endemic country like us, we might think of even TB, because they can present both with the non-granulomatous as well as granulomatous. We would like to ask for presence of any skin lesions, either in the form of skin ulcers or skin nodules or any other rashes on the skin, which might give us an diagnostic which aid. And otherwise, apart from that, also ask for aphthous ulcers or oral ulcers, which is also important. And additionally, for weight loss and for presence of any genital urinary ulcers. These are the things which we will commonly ask the patient when the patient first comes in, and with the first episode of uveitis. Apart from history of trauma and drug intake. These two are the important other things which we have to look keep in mind, because a number of, as I said, drugs and simple drugs can also induce a uveitis. So taking a drug history and any trauma history is also important in all these, in addition to this things which we ask for.
Okay, I think we have another question by Dr. Shweta. She wants to know when to start topical steroids in HSV anterior uveitis if the corneal epithelium is already involved.
So if the corneal epithelium is also affected, so that means you have an active ulcer, then you have to, in association with the cornea specialist, you will start first with whatever antiviral treatment topically they want to give. And probably you can, if so, see the degree of uveitis you have to look for. Okay? Because if the inflammation is not very severe, probably just giving a cycloplegic agent to dilate, keep the pupil dilated, will be helpful. And once the epithelium heals within a few days' time, probably 2-3 days' time, we can start them on steroids. Or if the cornea specialist thinks it's okay to start with the steroids, we can give them on a lower form, like loteprid and loteprednol and rather than the predfort or the higher steroids, we can start them on softer steroids. As well as many of these cases of viral keratouveitis will need systemic antiviral treatment, because just giving topical treatment is not useful, particularly for all the cases where there's already a uveitis there, because the intraocular penetration of the medicines and also the long duration. Many of the times, because these viruses, we know, are neurotrophic, they remain there, they keep causing recurrent attacks, so they will need a long-term duration of systemic antivirals. For a herpetic, acyclovir is the drug of choice. So if it's HSV, acyclovir, you can use a smaller dose, 400 mg, four to five times a day with initial dose. And then you can keep them on a lower dose after 2 weeks, reduce it, and then further reduce it on a maintenance dose, maybe 400 mg once for longer duration, 3 months to 6 months, depending on what type of corneal and uveal involvement is.
Clearances and what exact settings in the slit lamp. I think you mentioned it. Could you just highlight it again?
Yeah, so you can use a small slit, make a small slit of 1 into 1 millimeter size, and keep it on, keep it a wide slit beam, like 1 into 1 millimeter, and try to light slow, and use a high magnification and illumination to see the presence of the flare cells.
Okay. Thanks, Nidhi. And the last one would be, do you want the student to actually say it is a viral or a bacterial uveitis, or come up to the conclusion of tuberculoid etiology or a sarcoid etiology, or is it just suffice to say it is an acute granulomatous or a non-granulomatous uveitis, whether it is a recurrent or a first attack one in their exams? Is that okay to just say it as a granulomatous, non-granulomatous with the onset, or do they have to go into the detail and tell the etiology as well?
So if they say that, if they tell you, tell us an anatomical diagnosis, that is anterior, intermediate or posterior or a combined, and if they're able to tell it's a granulomatous or a non-granulomatous, and if they're able to tell probably it's a chronic or it's a recurrent, because there is, as based on the past telltale signs like pigments on the anterior lens capsule or broken synechiae. So if they're able to tell that, so these things like anterior non-granulomatous or an anterior granulomatous, chronic uveitis, with, in case there is an additional feature, they can mention that, like with the secondary glaucoma or with the secondary complicated cataract or with some cystoid macular edema or associated with spillover uveitis. If they're able to give this kind of a diagnosis, that is very, very good. If at all there is a, if there's some specific signs, like if it's a Fuchs uveitis, I think they should be able to tell it's a chronic uveitis and it probably looks like a Fuchs. And since they can add on to it by saying probably it is this, like they can say, it's a chronic granulomatous anterior, and it's probably because of sarcoidosis, I'm saying so. Then they have to tell, I'm saying so because the patient gave a history of having a dry cough, breathlessness, or had history of these painful skin nodules, something like that. So, you know, if they are able to, so that they will have to be telling only on the basis of their history or on their systemic examination if they have done and they have found any skin lesions or any mouth ulcers or something like that. So on that, if they are, or they find that the joints are, swollen or something like that, based on that they get it. But if they are giving the diagnosis of the anatomical, pathological and a clinical diagnosis, that is good enough, along with whatever complication they are seeing in the way. that should be good enough. And then they can say that I would like to investigate for what? Like suppose it's a granulomatous, I would like to investigate for this particularly. Or if it's an acute, I would like to do HLA-B27 test for this patient. If it's a pediatric case, a JIA, JIAs are more likely to be RA negative and ANA positive. So if they think that, okay, this child has a history of joint swellings, so I would like to do an ANA and could, because probably I'm thinking of a GIA. So if they are able to tell them, that's very, very good. But if at least if they are giving an anatomical, pathological and an acute or chronic kind of a diagnosis, along with whatever, cataract and glaucoma and cystoid macular edema, yes, maybe depending on the media haze, they should be able to tell if the media is very clear. If not, if at least this much they are saying, that should, I think, be good.
Okay, so with an added note of the complications which are being present, I think you mentioned yes. that as well. Okay.
Yes.
Niti, there's another question by Basant Yadav who wants to know how will we treat a patient who has come post cataract surgery 25 days after surgery. Patient has posterior uveitis and suggest us the treatment.
Okay, so now, so assuming that this cataract, you have examined the patient, cataract surgery is totally uncomplicated and gone on fine. So assuming, so you thought probably that this case was not seen because the cataract must have been dense or whatever reason, the posterior segment was not visible at that point of time because patient is coming with a posterior uveitis and no anterior chamber signs is what I'm assuming is the question. So if it's only a posterior uveitis, that means there's vitreous cells and there's a vitreous haze. And what type of posterior uveitis, whether there's choroidal lesions or not, you have to see. So now when you're saying it's a posterior uveitis, there is with or without an anterior uveitis, you should tell that. So there's no anterior uveitis, okay? Now it's only a posterior uveitis. How you're telling it is basically you saw a lot of vitreous cells, you saw vitreous haze. And when you do a fundus examination, you can see that, okay, the second order vessels are obscured or the first order vessels are obscured and you can see within this. So based on that, you can say that vitreous haze is grade 2, grade 3 or whatever. So that's one. The next thing is that you in the posterior segment, you have all the different structures. You have to define whether there is a optic disc papillitis or a neuroretinitis. That means the disc along with the adjacent retina is infected, inflamed or not, or a disc edema is there or not. If that is not there, then is there any macular, in the macula is there any pathology or not, is it macular edema or not? And if that is and then you have to look at the choroid at the level of, and the retina itself, look for any retinitis lesions where you can see something, you know, you can see if there's associated retinitis or if there's associated vasculitis, you can see this vascular sheathing or whether there's associated choroiditis. So based on, so just by saying posterior uveitis, it's difficult. But if you say yeah, posterior uveitis with a choroiditis, then you will say, okay, that means this wouldn't have come in 25 days time. So you know that this must have been a pre-existing, maybe missed because of the dense media haze due to cataract. Once the cataract is eliminated, now we are noticing that he has a posterior segment pathology. So you have to, that's why, as I said, you have to classify again, just like we classified anterior uveitis as granulomatous, non-granulomatous, like that you have to classify posterior uveitis as a vasculitis, as a choroiditis, a retinochoroiditis or a chorioretinitis, as a neuroretinitis or as a so all these. So once you've identified that, then accordingly you will investigate. That we will have one more class of a posterior segment uveitis. So once you find that, then you, so based on whatever you found, you will further investigate for it. And you wouldn't think of it as an endophthalmitis because it's just 25 days post-op. There is no signs of anterior uveitis, and without any conjunctival condition, without anterior uveitis, just having a posterior uveitis, usually endophthalmitis will not present like that. And or very, very rarely, the earliest sign of endophthalmitis might be some amount of vasculitis with a little vitreous haze. It might start like that, but then that is less common. Usually you will have some amount of anterochamber reaction if you're thinking of an post-op acute endophthalmitis.
Probably to sum up, we would actually classify the posterior uveitis, get to know what exactly it is, and then start on the treatment. I think that's exactly what you mentioned it. Thank you, Nidhi. Thank you very much for that insights into the approach to anterior uveitis. Thank you all for watching. Tomorrow at the same time, we will be having the next important topic on how to make corneal diagrams. The corneal case is usually kept in the exams, and making a corneal diagram basically with respect to color coding a slit lamp picture as to how it is to be drawn is very, very important for your exam. So we would be discussing on how to make corneal diagrams. That would be discussed by Dr. Pallavi Joshi, who is a corneal consultant here at Shankara Bangalore. So see you all tomorrow at the same time. Thank you again.
Thank you.